Grace and peace to you from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. It's good to be with you this morning in spirit. Our psalm comes from Psalm 130 for this week. And it reads, "Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my supplications. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, Lord, who could stand? But there's forgiveness with you, so that you may be revered. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is great power to redeem. It is he who will redeem Israel from all its iniquities." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
There is a sense of great longing that is the words of the psalmist this morning. More than the watchmen wait for the morning, so our soul waits for you. And in the midst of a time and season when we are stuck at home, where we are waiting the outcome of everything that's unfolding and the uncertainty that comes with that, there is a sense of longing, of desiring for something to happen, for deliverance to happen, for God to be at work. And so I think the words of the psalmist are appropriate this morning, that our hearts are in eager anticipation of being able to gather again. Our hearts long for a moment with God's presence to break in. We are longing and waiting more than even the watchmen wait for the morning. We know what it means to wait. And in the season of Lent, that is an especially appropriate thing to do. With Lent, we are learning again what it means to listen, to wait, to wander in the wilderness, being blown out by the Spirit, and waiting for God to speak. Even as Jesus was in the wilderness waiting for the Spirit to speak, he was tempted and tried. And so in these days, that's not necessarily unexpected. But the hope is, as the psalmist reminds us, that God is the one who will redeem. God is the one who will deliver. God is the one who will save. And for that reason, we have much to be grateful for, much to thank God for, and much to continue to praise God, even in the moments of difficulty. So let us continue to sing his songs together. But before we do, let us pray the prayer of confession together. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole hearts. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name.
Amen.
Now, church, receive this morning's benediction. May the peace of Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Also with you.
Let us continue worshiping in song by singing, "Open the eyes of my heart, Lord."
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. And open the eyes.
Let us continue worshiping in song by singing the beautiful hymn, "It Is Well With My Soul." Let us hear the word of the Lord. After she had said this, she went back and called her sister Mary aside. "The teacher is here," she said, "and is asking for you." When Mary heard this, she got up quickly and went to him. Now Jesus had not yet entered the village, but was still at the place where Martha had met him. When the Jews who had been with Mary in the house comforting her noticed how quickly she got up and went out, they followed her, supposing she was going to the tomb to mourn there. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him." But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?" Jesus, once again deeply moved, came to the tomb. It was a cave with a stone laid across the entrance. "Take away the stone," he said. "But Lord," said Martha, the sister of the dead man, "by this time there is a bad odor, for he has been in there 4 days." Then Jesus said, "Did I not tell you that if you believe, you will see the glory of God?" So they took away the stone. Then Jesus looked up and said, "Father, I thank you that you have heard me. I know that you always hear me, but I said this for the benefit of the people standing here, that they may believe that you have sent me." When he had said this, Jesus called out in a loud voice, "Lazarus, come out!" The dead man came out, his hands and feet wrapped with strips of linen and a cloth around his face. Jesus said to them, "Take off the grave clothes and let him go." And this is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us continue worshiping in song by singing, "Lord, I Need You."
You're
Would you pray with me? Holy God, that's the prayer of our hearts, the song of our mouths, that we need you. We need you. We need you now more than ever. We needed you 6 months ago, and we'll be sure to need you in the future. God, we find ourselves in a time of uncertainty and fear, loneliness, anxiety, you name it. Holy God, we are confessing today just how great our need for you is. Lord, we have a host of prayer requests as a church family, not only in this local context, but around the world. Pray for those who have fallen ill, that you would be their great physician. Bring them comfort and peace, not only for them, but also their loved ones. Lord, we pray for those who are feeling the stress of all the other little things in life that haven't stopped and haven't slowed down, and the new paths that they're having to navigate. Pray that you are especially close to them. God, I pray for those who have had so many things taken away in recent days. Things that were to be looked forward to, weddings, graduations, proms, birthdays, anniversaries, mission trips, vacations, Father, all of them were taken away. I pray that you meet us here in our grief of the things that we've lost, and you'll remind us again that you are more than enough. God, I pray specifically for your church, that we would shine bright during this time, this beam of hope for the world around us, especially those who are hurting and have no hope. Empower us to be brave and give us your wisdom. And we'll be sure in everything that we say, in everything we think, and in everything that we do, to give you the praise and the glory that you are most worthy. Love you, and we thank you for this opportunity to still be gathered even when we're separated. Be with us, Father, for we ask it in your name. Amen.
We are thankful for technology this morning, and for how technology allows us to continue to gather together online for worship, even when we are unable to gather together in person. But let me tell you, you are missed. I miss seeing your smiling faces this morning. I miss your hugs. I miss seeing people gathered around the altars here for prayer. So please know that you are missed. We love each of you very much. We are praying for you daily. And we pray that this worship time is an uplifting time for all of us together. I do want to make you aware of just a few announcements. Again, as most of you know, all of our services and activities here at St. Paul's Church of the Nazarene have been canceled for the next few weeks. But we want to continue to be connected, to continue to pray for one another, to continue to gather together in these online formats, even while we're unable to gather in person. And so we have various ways that we are making those things available throughout the week. We are doing a daily devotion. Pastor Levi, Pastor Jonathan, and I are sending those out via email and over Facebook. So if you would like to check those out, we would invite you to do so. Pastor Levi has been providing material for Wednesday night Bible studies still at home. So we invite you to check that out on Wednesday evenings. And then, of course, we're continuing to have our worship services streamed online on Sunday mornings. And I would encourage you throughout the week, just do your best to stay connected with one another. Give a call to someone, encourage them, send out a text, send out a card. We want to do our best to stay connected with one another, even while we are unable to gather together in person. I would invite you to turn in your Bibles this morning to the book of Ezekiel. We will begin reading from Ezekiel chapter 37, and we will be reading verses 1 through 14 this morning. Ezekiel chapter 37, and we will be reading verses 1 through 14. And God's word reads, "The hand of the Lord was on me, and he brought me out by the Spirit of the Lord and set me in the middle of a valley. It was full of bones. He led me back and forth among them, and I saw a great many bones on the floor of the valley, bones that were very dry. He asked me, 'Son of man, can these bones live?' I said, 'Sovereign Lord, you alone know.' Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to these bones and say to them, Dry bones, hear the word of the Lord. This is what the Sovereign Lord says to these bones. I will make breath enter you, and you will come to life. I will attach tendons to you and make flesh come upon you and cover you with skin. I will put breath in you and you will come to life. Then you will know that I am the Lord.' So I prophesied as I commanded. And as I was prophesying, there was a noise, a rattling sound, and the bones came together, bone to bone. I looked, and tendons and flesh appeared on them, and skin covered them, but there was no breath in them. Then he said to me, 'Prophesy to the breath. Prophesy, son of man, and say to it, This is what the Sovereign Lord says. Come, breath, come from the four winds and breathe into these slain, that they may live.' So I prophesied as he commanded me, and breath entered them. They came to life and stood up on their feet, a vast army. Then he said to me, 'Son of man, these bones are the people of Israel. They say our bones are dried up and our hope is gone. We are cut off. Therefore prophesy and say to them, This is what the Sovereign Lord says, My people, I am going to open your graves and bring you up from them. I will bring you back to the land of Israel. Then you, my people, will know that I am the Lord when I open your graves and bring you up from them. I will put my spirit in you and you will live, and I will settle you in your own land. Then you will know that I, the Lord, have spoken, and I have done it, declares the Lord." And this is the word of the Lord for us this morning. Thanks be to God. Have you ever had a really bad nightmare? I remember as a child, I had this recurring nightmare of being chased. Now, I never knew exactly who was chasing me, but I remember that each time I had this dream, I would be running and running and running as fast as I could down the street until I was out of breath and my lungs were burning. And finally, at the last minute, when I was too exhausted to continue on and was about to be overtaken by the person chasing me, I would wake up, often drenched in sweat, out of breath, so relieved to find out that it was just a bad dream. I can imagine that this vision of the valley of dry bones that comes to Ezekiel the prophet in our text seemed a little bit like a bad dream. It was a nightmarish type of vision for sure, the type of scene that you might find in a horror film. I can imagine that for Ezekiel, it was the type of scene that would cause the breath to catch in his chest, a scene that would make him long to avert his eyes, a scene that would make his stomach turn and leave him feeling horrified. Dry, dusty, brittle bones, bleached white by the hot, humid sun, scattered across the desert floor. It was a vision of an open grave of sorts, the remains of a people once alive and strong and full of dreams, now dead, their bodies discarded in that ruthless way that denied them even a proper burial. out of all the visions that you might desire to receive from God, this would not be one of them. It was no doubt a startling scene, a nightmarish vision, a landscape marked by death. But unlike my recurring nightmare as a child, this was not a nightmare that Ezekiel and the people had the option of waking up from. Instead, this nightmare, this valley of dry bones, had become their reality in exile. Hear their cries of lament. Our bones are dried up. Our hope is gone. We are cut off. You see, the prophet Ezekiel and the people of Israel could identify all too well with those dusty, dry, brittle bones. Like those bones scattered across the desert floor, the people felt like their lives had been scattered, discarded, devalued in the place of exile. Whereas life had once been good and full and abundant back in their homeland of Jerusalem, now that life seems like little more than a distant memory here in Babylon. Exile, like that valley of dry bones, was a scene of death. A graveyard for past dreams. Exile was an impossible situation, a dead end, a closed door, a void future, a bad dream that you could not wake up from. In exile, there was no way forward, and there was no way out. And as the days in exile turned into years, the despair for the people of God only grew and grew. At first, they had been so certain that God would step in and deliver them, just as God had done so many times before. Early on, they had cried out to God, lifting countless prayers to the heavens, certain that God would hear their cries and come down to defend them, to deliver them from this hour of trial. But as time passed and their situation remained unchanged, despair became their constant companion. It seemed cruel that in their time of greatest need, in their darkest hour, when they needed God the most, God seemed absent, distant, silent. Exile, like that valley of dry bones, became a place where the only future for the people of God seemed to be one of death. In the midst of these uncertain days that we find ourselves living in, perhaps we too find ourselves identifying all too well with those dry, dusty, brittle bones. Perhaps we hear the cries of lament coming from our own lips. Our bones are dried up. Our hope is gone. We are cut off. Though we don't find ourselves living in a place of exile this morning, the reality is that we don't have to look far at the landscape of our world to see those places that are so like the valley that Ezekiel must have seen in this vision. Those places where life is stripped of value and the remains of life are haphazardly discarded across the desert floor. Those places where sin and death seem to reign. Those places where life seems to be spinning outside of control, that place where even the plans and promises of God seem called into question. Maybe this morning, even in these moments together, we find ourselves confronted with our own vision of dry bones, our own nightmare from which we cannot awake. The dry bones of a health pandemic, the dry bones of a failing economy, the dry bones of a tanking retirement plan, the dry bones of cancer diagnosis, the dry bones of the death of a loved one, the dry bones of a failing marriage, the dry bones of struggling to make ends meet, the dry bones of job loss, the dry bones of past mistakes, the dry bones of addiction, the dry bones of depression and anxiety, the dry bones of an uncertain future. Friends, we may not find ourselves living in exile, but we are no strangers to the valley of dry bones. Right. We are no strangers to those places and situations where sin seems to reign and death seems to have the last word and the upper hand time and time again. We are no strangers to hearing the cries of lament coming from our own lips and wondering for ourselves, where is God in the midst of all? Where is God in the midst of all of this. We may not live in exile, but friends, we are no stranger to the valley of dry bones. It is in that valley, filled with all of those dry, dusty, brittle bones, that God appears on the scene and asks Ezekiel a very strange question. The kind of question that might make us shake our heads in confusion. Son of man, can these bones live? It seems like the obvious answer is no. No, of course, God, these bones cannot live. Don't you know? These are the bones of dead people. It's far too late. Maybe if these people had not chosen the way of sin, maybe, God, if you had stepped in before these bones had become dry and dusty, maybe if this situation had not gotten so far out of control, maybe then these bones could have lived. But now? No, God, of course these bones cannot live. Of course these dusty, dry bones scattered across the desert floor have no life remaining in them. Some obstacles are just too great to overcome. Some situations are just too far beyond repair. No, no, God, seems to be the obvious answer. But Ezekiel answers this question differently than you or I might expect. Ezekiel doesn't automatically answer with the obvious, no, God, of course these bones cannot live. Instead, Ezekiel says something really important here. He says, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Every time I read this text, I am so blown away by Ezekiel's response. Sovereign Lord, you alone know. In this valley place where all he can see are dry bones and where death seems to have already had the last word, Ezekiel does not place limits on God. But instead, he makes space for God to be God and for God to work as only God can. And in working as only God can, in that valley-like place, God does what seems impossible. God instructs Ezekiel to begin prophesying to these dry, dusty, brittle bones. Now talk about preaching to a hopeless audience. Talk about a futile task. It was the type of task that if anyone in their right mind would have witnessed him preaching to this pile of dry, dusty, brittle bones, they would have assumed that he had lost his mind. This guy is off his rocker. But in obedience to God, no matter how futile it may seem, Ezekiel does as God commands him to. He begins prophesying. He begins preaching to these dusty, dry, brittle bones. And to his amazement, things begin to happen. A rattling sound begins to fill Ezekiel's ears as the bones begin to shake in their places. And then these rattling bones begin to fit together just as they were always intended to. Tendons and flesh appearing and skin covering the bones. And these dry, dusty, brittle bones begin to take the shape of a body once again. But still, there is a problem. There is no life in these bones, in these bodies. But God is not done. In another strange request, God commands Ezekiel to prophesy for the wind, the breath to come and to fill these bodies. And as Ezekiel again is faithful to obey, God begins to breathe God's very life, God's very breath into these dusty, dry, brittle bones. The God who breathed life into the dust in the beginning to create humanity breathes God's very breath, God's very spirit into these dry bones to bring them to new life once again. There in that valley place where life seems to be reduced to dead ends and dry bones, God once again displays God's power as the creator and sustainer and giver of life. We can only imagine what it must have been like for Ezekiel to witness that transformation. We can only imagine what it was like to see firsthand the power that God displays in that place of death. It had to be truly incredible. Friends, it is so often in those valley-like places of our world, where all we can see are dead ends and dry bones, that God appears on the scene and asks us as the church the same question that God asked Ezekiel. Church, can these bones live? And my guess is that we want to respond with a resounding yes. Yes, God, we believe that you can bring life to these dead bones. My guess is that we want to be found faithful as Ezekiel was and to have hope that God can do a work of new creation even in the place of death. But sometimes the temptation for our world today, and even for the church, is to get so caught up in the scene of dry bones, for our eyes to become so fixed on the brokenness that we fail to see how God can work in the midst of it. We struggle to imagine how God can bring life from a place so marked by death, how God can redeem situations so broken by sin, how God can take the dry bones that we see all around us and bring them to new life once again. Friends, it's so easy for us to look around at the valley-like situations of our world and to become discouraged, defeated, fearful about what tomorrow may bring. And when God comes to us in those valley-like places and asks us that familiar question, church, can these bones live? Too often our response is to look around at the brokenness and to quickly declare it hopeless, beyond repair, beyond redemption, beyond grace. No, God, of course these bones cannot live. That person is too far gone. That pandemic is too big. That marriage is too broken. It is too late. Those finances are too small. It's been that way too long. The odds are too great. The cancer is too advanced. The chains of addiction are too strong. The grave is too powerful. But my friends, let us not forget this morning that we serve a God of resurrection, a God who is in the business of raising up dry bones to new life, a God who shows up in the valley-like places filled with dead ends and dry bones and shows us what God alone can do. It is God who comes and challenges the status quo that says life is no longer possible here. It is God who comes and breathes life once again into our dry bones and the dead-end situations of our world, bringing forth new life from the very place where death seemed to reign. Right. And friends, we know that God has the power to bring life from death. Not only because of what God did with these dry, dusty, brittle bones in Ezekiel's day, but because of what God later did through the life, death, resurrection, and ascension of Jesus Christ our Lord. Because we serve a risen King, because we serve a God of resurrection, we can trust that there are no bones too dry, no problems too big, no forces too strong to thwart God's plan of redemption for us and for the rest of creation. Church, no matter how much it may look like it now, no matter how hopeless these situations we are facing may seem, no matter how vast the landscape of dry bones around us may appear, because of what God has done through Christ Jesus our Lord, sin and death no longer have the power to speak the final word over us. It may not always be in the ways we expect. It may not always come in the timing that we want, but the God who breathed life into our dust in the beginning is still in the business of breathing life into the dry, dusty bones of our world today. And my friends, one glorious day, God will complete the work that he began in Christ Jesus, and all things will be made new. The valley of dry bones will be no more. Only life and life abundant will remain. Thanks be to God through Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. We look forward to that day with anticipation, and the cry of our hearts is, come, Lord Jesus, come. But until that day comes, when Christ returns and all is set right again, church, we have a calling. Notice that God did not raise these bones to new life by God's self. Instead, God included Ezekiel in this act of redemption. In the midst of the valley of dry bones, Ezekiel is given the message of hope to take back to his people in that place of death, telling them that that place of death, that place of exile, will not speak the final word over them. Exile will not be their end. God has not given up on them. God has not abandoned them. God has not forsaken them. And church, God desires for us to take this same good news message to a world filled with despair. God calls us as God's people to step out in faith as Ezekiel did and to prophesy to the dry bones of our world today. We as the church have a beautiful calling to be a people sent out on mission to proclaim the good news of God found in Christ Jesus our Lord. We carry with us wherever we go the good news that God has not given up on us. God has not abandoned us. God has not forsaken us. But even now, even here in this valley-like place where all we can see are dead ends and dry bones, even here, God is at work restoring and redeeming and making all things new.
Right.
Friends, the good news is that the valley of dry bones will not be our end. Life and life eternal awaits. My prayer for us in the midst of these uncertain days is that we might have a faith like that of Ezekiel. And when God comes to us and shows us that vision of dry bones and asks us that familiar question, can these bones live? May we have the faith to make space for God to work as only God can. And faithfully say, Sovereign Lord, you alone know. Let us pray. Almighty God, we are so thankful for your word this morning. We are so thankful for the hope that it brings to our tired and weary spirits. We are so thankful to be reminded of what you can do even in the valley of dry bones, even in those places that seem to be marked by sin and death. God, we believe this morning. We believe that you are a God who brings life even in the places of death, that you are a God who brings hope in the places of despair, that you are a God that shines light into the midst of our darkness. God, open our eyes this morning that we might see what you are doing in the midst of the valley of dry bones that we see all around us. Give us eyes to see the ways that even now, even here in this place, you are breathing life into our dry, dusty bones and raising us up to new life. Give us eyes to see. And God, we ask that you would give us a faith like that of Ezekiel. That when you show us a vision of dry bones and you come asking us that familiar question, can these bones live? May we have the faith to believe that you are able. May we have the faith to be expectant of what you can do even in the place of death. May we carry this message of good news out into our world, that others might hear the good news that you are still at work. You are still able. You are still redeeming and restoring and making new. Help us to be a faithful people to prophesy to the dry, dusty bones of our world today. Give us the words to speak. Give us the hearts of obedience. Give us the message to proclaim. And we will be faithful to do so this morning. Encourage us, uplift us, give us eyes to see what you are doing even now, even here. We ask these things in the mighty name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen. Church, please receive this benediction. Go out into the valley places of our world, where all you can see are dead ends and dry bones, and prophesy that even here, even now, God is raising up our dry, dusty bones to new life. Let us go singing his praises.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Go in His grace and peace. You are dismissed.